the Eternal One, who was, and is to come. Amen. Between the recent school shooting in Oakland, a suicide bombing of an educational center in Afghanistan, the escalation of aggression by Russian leadership against Ukraine, not to mention the ravages of Hurricane Ian on the heels of Hurricane Fiona's devastation, there has been more violence and suffering than our world can bear, even when we fall to our knees in prayer. Today, I find myself deeply grateful for that prophet most of us have heard precious little about, Habakkuk, whose potent words of lament and protest seems to touch the anguish of my own soul, seeing all that is not well within our world. Violence, strife, contention, destruction, his ancient words mirror our present reality. Habakkuk's voice is one among the Book of the Twelve, a grouping of the shorter prophetic texts in the Hebrew Bible. And even for his relative obscurity, Habakkuk's mighty witness in our scriptural canon is a gift. For the prophet demonstrates that we do not need to be afraid to speak frankly with God from the depths of our lived experience. This is good news for all of us, and perhaps especially for the prophets among our midst, whose voices the church often finds tricky to hear. Faith, after all, dares us to be honest and courageous. Taking the risk to speak the truth orients our hearts in that Godward direction toward which faith always seeks to move us. The divine vision for a transformed world where injustice, idolatry, and corruption are no more is that blessed future for which Habakkuk eagerly awaits, straining like a watchman to see God's salvation at hand. It is the divine dream for which we also watch and pray, not only every Sunday in our prayer for mission, but from generation to generation. For we know the reign of God brings justice and joy, as love's power transforms all things. This is the future Habakkuk is instructed to write on tablets so that it can be shared abroad as inspiration to the righteous, who God says shall live by faith, even unto the vision's appointed time. Before these COVID times, I had opportunity to visit the Atlanta History Center during my years living there, and I got to participate in a simulation of the historic Freedom Rides, those legendary interracial bus rides launched by student activists traveling between Washington, D.C. and Mississippi to challenge segregation on interstate buses and bus terminals. I had no idea what I was signing up for in that experience. Even three prior visits to Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture did not prepare me for the intensity of imagining stepping back into that time in history as part of a cohort from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee undertaking such dangerous and daring rides. These rides, combined with boycotts and sit-ins backed by the National Christian Leadership Conference, garnered national media attention and forced the hand of federal officials to implement and hold accountable the states for policy changes that aligned with Supreme Court decisions taken in the 1960s. Only when the Interstate Commerce Commission officially banned segregation in all facilities under its jurisdiction did those segregated tendencies finally come to an end. Ella Baker was a significant organizer in this era. Her instrumental efforts in the struggle for civil rights developed young leaders in the student protest movement. She saw their initiative and courage and identified with their prophetic like struggle. By amplifying the moral implications of their labors and supporting student-centered ways of organizing and self-educating in the years leading up to these historic freedom rides, Baker inspired and guided emerging leaders in our world to think about the root causes of racialized oppression and to work effectively together towards societal transformation. Baker herself had grown up hearing stories of her grandmother's lived experience, a woman who had been whipped for refusing to marry the person that her enslaver picked out for her. Surely Baker must have known that precious cost of walking by faith one slow step at a time into a long-awaited future while watching with the prophets of every era for love's power to recreate our world. October is the appointed time for reflecting on stewardship at St. Paul's, a season in our communal life where we prayerfully engage that charge that the Apostle Paul issued to Timothy that we heard lifted up in today's epistle reading, where we are invited to consider, alongside Timothy, that treasure of faith entrusted to us by our mothers and grandmothers and grandparents from generations past, the treasure of faith that we too can choose to cultivate for the sake of love, now and for future generations. This past week was also the appointed date for our diocesan clergy retreat up at Bishop's Ranch, and I had no idea that this retreat would nudge me to consider how we are called as people of faith to engage the pain of our world as a sacred responsibility, perhaps even an opportunity to practice our call as stewards of this future that God has appointed for the world. It might sound strange to start stewardship season as we think about this annual journey of discerning how God calls us to participate in the life of this church and the life of the world as people of faith, pledging our time, energy, and financial resources to steward this life we share in Christ. But Joanna Macy's The Work That Reconnects provided the foundation of our retreat time. And one of her sacred practices is something called honoring our pain for the world. As we engaged with this ancient practice of bearing witness to particular realities in our world that we carry in our hearts, that we hold before God in our prayers, that we pray with and wrestle with as we contemplate our own works of mercy and solidarity, we got to hear many stories of suffering, grief, and loss in those conversations. Stories of experiences known in our lives, in the lives of those we love. Stories that involve indeed all creaturely beings alive on this planet in this time. And in the sharing of those stories, I found myself overwhelmed with gratitude, with the tender compassion of our Creator, who surrounds us and our world with saving grace. This love strengthens and renews the unity we are made to know as people who long to be redeemed by love's healing power. This is the perfect love which raised Jesus from the dead. It is the force that animates our life together as God's goodness renews and recreates us all. Love is the communal treasure that we cherish, because St. Paul's is a sacred refuge for us and for many in seasons where we are overwhelmed by personal grief, loss, and pain. It's also a place where we strengthen our commitment and courage to serve our surrounding community and indeed the wider world through the love Christ commissions us to share. The global circumstances around us may seem to resist God's dream for humanity. Habakkuk yet reassures us that divine promises never lie. God's reign of justice and joy will transform the world. Though it tarry, Together we will wait for this promised redemption, even as we summon communal courage to love fiercely in word and deed, daring to be counted among the righteous who shall live by faith.